Great. Come on in, guys, have a seat. Anybody who's in my class who's not here has failed. In the back, we decided that's a new function called autofail. My name is Patrick Boozer. I am a freelance television programmer. I do a lot of live music, televised award shows, music concerts, that kind of thing. And today we're going to talk about live event programming on the EOS console. Live event programming is not typically a function we think of with EOS. It's a very theatrical-based platform. But that never stops sales managers from selling IONs to small houses that do rental concerts and that sort of thing. So it is an important concept to have in the desk and for certain people to know. How many of you guys are like head electricians or anything at a small theater? I come from your stock. I started as a stage manager, and that didn't pay very well, so I had to work on the electrics crew. That paid better. There was equipment and computers that broke, and people don't like that, and I didn't seem to mind it. And so, you know, you work your way up. I was the head electrician at the Orpheum Theater for a long time. And then I transitioned to television. Somebody came through with a show called So You Think You Can Dance. They didn't have a conventional programmer. He and I got along, and, you know, he took me with them. I got a union card. This will be our 10th season together this year. He and I are like the co-production designers of that show. So he's the lighting designer. We've taken away the set and now we're the set designers. You know, so you see this like random progression, and that's something you should expect in all of your careers if you're young, whatever you think you might be doing. Who knows? It's a big world out there. So I do have two confessions. One, I don't really busk anymore. And I definitely don't do it on this platform all that much. Every once in a while I do, but instead of like teaching televised music cueing, I think it's better to do busking because that's probably what most everyone here is doing. The second is when I agreed to do this speech, I was pretty sure, I had no reason to think that we wouldn't be on the 2.4 beta and I'd have all these like really nice wow moments to show you guys on the fader rework because it has been promised. We know what we need to do. But we got a lot of this really cool color code, and even looking at some of the show files in our class from the 2.2 to the 2.3, we had one desk that was on 2.2, and the colors on that desk were so wacky. You know, it's kind of made me a convert to the work that they've done. But the mathematics were hard, the processes were hard. Development in general is hard, so here we are. So I don't have a ton of like huge wow moments for you, but we will talk about basic philosophy, setup, and that kind of thing. So how about, I'll show you guys just a video of like what I do music cueing wise. I hear a lot about how EOS simply cannot do music. The style of programming I do is a lot like busking. A lot of it's over here on the faders, and then I run a master cue list, and we'll talk about how that's broken up, but the master cue list does the big moments, and then the faders do the little bits. You hit the mission, fire and ice, you water in a whiskey burn. We kiss, we fight, make up all night. You're the blessing and the curse.
I don't ever wanna break this chain. I don't ever wanna walk away. Cause I ain't never gonna find another love that made me feel this way.
Over and over and over, we say that.
So there's some music queuing on the EOS. Seemed to do all right. A couple things to know about that. That's about 5 queues, maybe 6 looks, and about 5 or 6 submasters. There's no time code. There's no, none of that. It's just played like you'd play a musical instrument. One little analogy, sometimes people who don't really know our industry very well, they ask me what I do, and it's kind of hard to explain. So I usually just say, I'm a really good parachute maker. And I don't know what that means. I was like, yeah, every day we go up in the airplane and somebody hands me what, you know, the parts that they think make a parachute, and then they shove me out of the plane. And, I know I'm good at it because I have yet to hit the ground all that hard. Sometimes it's not pretty. The landing, it's hard to stick the landing. But, you know, when you've got to be a parachute maker and you're using somebody else's ideas or whatever, you know, that song you just looked at, I ended up programming it in about 4 hours. They called me on a Wednesday, said, we want to pre-shoot these magic panels on Friday for Lady Antebellum. I said, great, awesome. What magic panels? And we didn't send you the drawings? I said, no. Oh, there's 3 looks in contention, and we want to use this one. I said, that's great, will you just send me that one, and we'll see if we can do it on Friday. So I got the look on Thursday. A couple hours to like patching or whatever. And since I'm a good parachute maker, I already had a bunch of tools in place. So we were able to set up the rig, pre-program it. A guy came in with a camera. We shot it a few times. He sent it off to the creative director of the show, who bought off on the look. They turned, you know, the whole back wall and all that stuff into all that video content you saw. And I really never saw the rig again until we were on site in Dallas with Lady Antebellum standing on it. So when we talk about live event programming for EOS and busking, you know, there's a few things to keep in mind. One, there's really no best practices. It's the Wild West. I'm going to teach you guys about what I do. That's just the way it is. The other thing is we're using our rig from the Programmer 2 class. This is our live music rig. If you guys are designing small concerts in your space, one thing you can do to like really just help yourselves out, you'll notice all the equipment is behind the artist. There's different forms of equipment out there. If you want a nice contrasty look, just go ahead and put everything behind your artist, light him with a follow spot, and you won't have to worry, especially if you've got IMAG and stuff, of like stuff crossing all over their faces and that kind of thing. But that's just kind of personal preference. So when we talk about having a parachute, what are we talking about? There's a couple things with EOS that you just gotta get over. One is it's a content-driven system. You have to have content to do anything with it. You take channels, you make content, you put them in a target, you play that target back. To make an effect, you take channels, you put them in a palette or whatever, and then you've got to make an absolute effect, and then you apply that absolute effect to the channel, then you put those channels in a submaster, it goes on and on. So you can't show up to a 6-hour gig where you don't know what the gear is, you don't know what the music is, maybe the music's not even in English. Somebody's going to hand you a set list in Vietnamese where someone has scribbled fast, medium, slow, medium, fast. Right? You can't show up at a gig like that, hit file new, start from scratch, and expect to land safely. You're not going to have a good day. So the first thing we got to get around is this concept of content and how do we build it. So we want to be looking at content that we can build that is fixture type non-specific, that can be applied to any fixture. A great example of this is a selection of intensity effects. They can play across anything. You want to find things that are transferable between venues, you know, things that you can bring with you from show to show to show to show so that you have like a big toolkit. You need to make these things easily findable. You need to make them easily deployable. You know, for the guys in our class and gal, we look at your screens and, you know, we don't give you guys a lot of tools about how to set up direct selects and all that kind of thing. So we see this sort of menagerie of screen layouts as you guys kind of wrestle with the fact that direct selects can be difficult to lay out, especially with a lot of content. Number schemes, I could spend 8 hours talking about numerology and how to make numbers easily memorizable. Most people want their number schemes as short as possible because they think pressing the key is the hardest thing. Remembering, if you've got 4,000 discrete channels of data or even 300 discrete channels of data, starting at one and going through 300 is a surefire way to not remember anything, right? So I typically put almost everything in a four-digit number address. Location one, fixture type one, location one, and, you know, 99 channels of up and down stage. We do shows in big arenas and stuff, so it's all very linear. If you're in a small theater and everything's, you know, kind of mushed together, maybe you got to do the same numerology, but by focus, which is what people normally do. You know, 101, 102, 103, 104. We all do some scheme of that, but if you want to be better at what you're doing, take it to the next level. It's just something to be constantly thinking about. So things that we can build that are fixture type, non-specific, and transferable between venues: effects, palettes, macros. A lot of people ask, what's your favorite macro? I've got 900 macros. My favorite macro is the synergy of macros. There's no like one macro that I find to be particularly interesting, but when you mix 200 of them together in a nice screen layout, you can actually move very fast. We don't traditionally think of palettes as something you can transfer, but we'll talk about that. Basic cue list and fader page layouts, if there are things that you are always doing all the time, there's no reason why you can't pre-build those and then populate those with data later. And that's just some way to speed up everything you're doing. I've got two rules. One, keep it simple. A few of you in here, I know, and you're like, that's the guy with the 1,300 effects and the desk that, you know, crashes because the show file's too big. But everything is laid out really simply. I can get to it anytime I need to. So wherever you're starting out, you've got to keep it simple. There's no point in having 100 focus palettes if you can't get to them, if you don't remember what they are, and if you don't have time to populate them. The other big rule, it doesn't matter what it looks like. So I'm kind of being cheeky with this because I know I'm with a theater crowd and we spend a lot of time crafting what I might call unique and special snowflakes. We don't, on the kinds of shows we're talking about, we typically don't have time. So my television shows, I'll have 9 days to do, you know, something like the Grammys. When I say 9 days, I mean on day one, I walk in, the other programmers walk in, I'm not alone, right? There's the moving light programmers, I do strobes and whatever. But when we walk in, the motors are on the ground, maybe some truss has been laid out. There's a rigging company that's been in for maybe 8 hours overnight, but everything has to be built custom on day one. By day five, after five 24-hour shifts, I mean, the guys got the gear up. If anyone's ever teched out 40 moving lights and thought, wow, that sucks, because they're broken. if you tech out 700 or 1,200 moving lights in a two-day period, wow, that sucks, because, you know, they're a long way away. And then we do 2 or 3 days of rehearsal, and then we do a show. So it's not a lot of time. That sense of time gets even more truncated when you do a busking show, because maybe you've got 6 hours. You've got 28 songs. Maybe you have lights you know, maybe you don't. So you gotta find ways to get all that kind of work done. One of those ways is to give up on the specificity of the looks and build out a distributed platform creating looks. One of the ways I deal with this is I made a homemade auto palettes engine. So I could do 3 hours on this actually, but basically what I did was I took a master channel. And my master channel's really cool. It's CMYRGBAW. It's got 5 gobo wheels, and they all spin, and it's got 2 gobo wheels, or color wheels, and all the color wheels got 20 palettes and stuff. And for all of these palettes, my master channel has the appropriate data. And then I made a macro that said, go look for group 9000 or 9001 or whatever it is, and shove the master channel's data at the contents of this group and make all those by type. And so we got a bunch of by type palettes that are already linked to a bunch of effects. And that's the most important thing that we can talk about right now. In terms of keeping it simple, I use these 30 color palettes. I use them for every show I do. It's enough for me. If you need to mix a special color, it's no problem. I know your designers talk about, you know, Roscoe this and Lee that, so maybe this doesn't necessarily work when they're asking for stuff, but when they want you to build effects quickly, they're not gonna mind. Now, one of the things, we'll do this when we look at the effects. So focus palettes, I tend to do 10 focus palettes. I tend to name them this. I didn't get pictures in here, but they're all kind of simple. Home, down, up, a cross look, another cross look, another cross look. P4 and P5, position 4, position 5. I'm not really sure what they do, but they're already referenced in the effects engine. You walk into a room and all you need to do is update these 10 focus palettes and suddenly you have all of these effects that work pretty nicely with your rig. That's a manageable amount of work that you can do. Same thing with the color palettes. Even, you know, if you have like just a big copy to with color palette stuff, maybe it's not copying to very accurately because your fixtures aren't calibrated. But at least updating 10 or 20 color palettes isn't as difficult as writing 10 or 30 effects. And for you guys in my class, you know, you got asked to write an effect, and the first thing you had to do was go to the effect editor, copy one of the standard effects, try to put the data in, look at it the way it would work. You weren't really sure how it was gonna work. So it's better to come in with a rack of things that you already know how they work. So my effects engine looks like this. It's based on 4 shapes. This PowerPoint should be available on your stick. And for all the students in my class, on the student USB, you'll see PowerPoints. All the PowerPoints are in there. So if, you know, take all the pictures you want, but we did try to make it available. So step, wave, pulse, and ramp. You can see the time in an absolute effect, and you can see the waveform. These are just different shapes that can be applied to intensities, to certain kinds of color, to whatever. They're just timing values. Up at the top there, you see my standard construction for an effect that's an absolute effect. I like 2-part absolute effects. The first step is going to be whatever the record target is, whatever the palette is. It's a color, it's a focus palette, it's whatever. The second step is going to be the background state of the existing cue. To get to that background state, you just select the level, hit at enter, it'll say background. So if you make an effect that is no color on background, if your background is in red, it'll make a red no color effect. A lot of people in the room may say, well, I really like to put both, you know, both of the colors in my effect so I know exactly what it's gonna do, and that's fair enough. But if you have a rack of 10 color palettes and you wanna make effects for all of them, you can do it this way and have each combination within 10 effects, or you can combine them all and need to make 90 effects to make the same relative amount of combinations. And if you wanna make something, you know, based on different kinds of shapes, you can see how quickly it kind of escalates. So I use a ton of magic sheets. I've got a bunch of effects magic sheets that I use. This is how they lay out. You can see there's some navigation at the bottom, which allows me to move back and forth between different kinds of effects. We'll throw up something like this. So you can see my magenta red effects, my multicolor effects, and they're all really easy to access. It's all 1 or 2 button presses away. The way that might work in real life, you might select a group of channels, gotta clear the command line, because that's helpful, and you might put them in a blue, and then you might go to your red effects, and you might choose a red effect. That was great, that was 2 steps, you can do it in about 5 seconds, but your designer's like, I like the red, but can we do it on yellow? Yes, we can. It's really just not a big deal. It's red on yellow, and I like the yellow, but I'd really like to do that with white, and you realize, well, you don't, you know, want to be a theatrical programmer, but anyway. So by building an array of things that you can use, you can create structures that allow you to get in and out of things very quickly and give you the majority of situations that you might run into. There are definitely other ways to do it, but this is how I build almost all of my effects. What's next? Show file navigation. So when you have a massive amount of data, right? You've sat down and in your downtime, you've made all these things. How are you going to display it all? You've got to think about show file navigation. I've left this intentionally blank because in some ways, this is what we give you. There's not like a great way to navigate in between screens. I use a lot of magic sheets, and this macro that's up at the top, this is how I navigate between different tabs of magic sheets. You can write macros that'll fire just a specific magic sheet. Magic sheet 1/5 will give you view 5 on magic sheet 1. Unless you fire that from another tab that already has a magic sheet, and then the desk doesn't know what to do. So one thing, when we did 2.2, we broke the screens up into a bunch of different places, and we made the tab numbers a lot more sticky. And that way, you could write macros that would reference a specific tab number. So for the people in my class, we'll talk about this later, but you break out an array of tab numbers, and then you can just drive magic sheets into those. So it's like a tab-specific snapshot. So instead of recording a snapshot for an entire screen, which is a lot better than a five-screen snapshot, right? Because snapshots don't really tell you about where you want to go. They just tell you, at some point in the past, I kind of like this screen. I did a brief calculation with all the little magic sheets and how they connect and stuff, and I came up with something like 60,000 different screen combinations for this show file, possible to access within one or two button clicks. And that sounds like a lot, but really it's just a menu system that you would find on any computer or whatever. If we were to look in the show file itself, you'll see, I've got this tab here. This tab would do, you know, stuff for a specific song. I've broken my show files up into 25 songs. That encompasses most of the work that I do. Each song gets its own page of that. Over here is another magic sheet that just does groups, presets, intensity palettes, focus palettes. And it's broken up by page. There's not a lot of content in this one. And it's just for the generic stuff that I use. Again, one or two button presses, and down here, color palettes, effects, that kind of thing. So I can be working in Song 2, work at a specific set of effects, and be adjusting presets of my generic flavor all at the same time. All right, so now that you've spent months and months and months doing all that, you got to figure out how you're going to program the music itself. And so the first thing you really need to do is think about how you're going to partition your rig. The other thing about EOS that you kind of got to get over is that it's a move fade desk. It's not a preset desk, no matter how hard we try to make it. And so if you have enough gear to partition into different things, you're going to have a lot more fun because you're not going to have all these like crazy move fades happening with all this out-of-sequence, nonlinear stuff. So the best way to break things up, think about a set of bass look fixtures. Bass look fixtures are going to play almost all the time, and bass look fixtures want to be safe. Things like washes, LED, things that can do live transitions from whatever they're in to wherever they're going and not look horrible. An example of not a good bass look fixture is something like a Sharpie. It doesn't have a CMY, it's just got a color wheel, and it's got a bunch of gobos, and they move super fast, and they kind of snap out. If you put that in your bass look, you're always going to be rolling through gobos and that kind of thing. I tend to make two or three sets of channels for like specialty looks. This all just kind of depends on your rig. For our Programmer 2 class, we had a magic sheet that looked like this. I went ahead and broke up my channels into these kind of looks. I took a bass look, I put all the wash lights, I put all the psych lights, and I put the band backlight. Those are gonna play pretty much all the time. And then I made a bunch of effects groups. I broke the Sharpies up into three groups. I think it's now two. We got some LED blinders in the back, and then we have that wall of color blasty pixel map stuff. The next thing we do with basic show structure is Q-list subs, you know, what are we trying to do? We're trying to make a distributed control system that's kind of broken up by different attributes, broken up by color, broken up by focus, broken up by intensity. And you, since we can't filter, you've got to make sure as you're recording all of these different things, you can't filter at the playback level. You can filter at the record level, so that's where you need to do it. Yeah, let's see. So more basic show structure stuff. It's helpful to be very consistent with your numbering schemes. I like to, you know, put basics in 1 through 100 or whatever, and then put specialty stuff in 101 through 200. It kind of doesn't matter what kind of data it is, just as long as you have a consistent numbering scheme, because the more consistent you are, the easier it is to build macros that are transferable. So if you always know that your effect subnasters are in a certain range, you can build macros that just release all your effects. You don't need to know what those effects are. They're going to be somewhere within the range of 101 through 200. It's doubtful within a 4-hour call you're going to make so many effects submasters that you break the ceiling for the 100 subs that you've given yourself. Same thing for cue lists, same thing for groups. You know, it's great to make macros that say all my bass fixtures do this. So if all your bass fixtures are always in group whatever it is, that's, you know, macros are a really good way to reference concepts that are transferable between venues. In terms of basic show structure, this is what I put in my main list. I got a generic cue, I got a button cue that cleans everything up, and I have an applause cue in case my button cue is too bright. And that's basically it. Now that is not to say in my main cue list I only have three cues, but I only have one concept. I might duplicate this 4 or 5 or 6 times and make those button cues look different, because you don't always want a button in bright white. And then you can make some macros, right? You get into a slow song, you got plenty of time to hit that macro that says, ah, we're gonna button in the slow blue button. And then you just load a secondary set of lists into a secondary set of cues into your main cue list so that when you hit go on that, it's going to clean everything up, but it's gonna do it in a different way. So the generic cue, what's important is that it always looks appropriate. It's not blinding to your artist. This is the cue you're gonna go to in between every song. This is how we do it in a television show. I would advise doing it in a live show. You're gonna do it this way in a concert. This is when your artist is talking and just kind of freelancing. You don't know how long it's gonna take. It just wants to look nice-ish. It wants to be easy to get into and out of. So washes, LED fixtures, anything that can get in and out easily without tracking through a bunch of gobos and stuff. So you can make the nicest gobo array in the world. Don't put it in your generic cue just because people are gonna look at it for a long time, because you're gonna struggle to get in and out of it all the time. You're not gonna have time to make all these cues to fade stuff in, mark it somewhere else, fade it back up, right? It's very quick, 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 because music is occurring. The button cue, typically it's nice if it plays well with the generic cue. Oftentimes you'll get a lot of live snapping going into the button, which is fine. Typically when that happens, it's an upbeat song and it's just ended. So we're kind of okay with that. But to get back to the generic cue, people are clapping, your artist might be talking, like all the excitement just ended. So it's okay to have like an ugly when things are exciting, but when things have toned down, it's just much less appropriate. And then the applause cue, it's just something to think about. Maybe your button cues are too bright and you need to go to some sort of applause thing. Your button cue, a good way to clean stuff up in EOS. I tend to block them, which I don't really need to do because there's not a lot of cues in that cue list, not a lot of editing, but I do like to assert them, do an all fade, and doing a full effect stop. In 2.3, we added the ability to do a full effect stop that will stop effects in any channel you ask it to, even though it's not deriving effects from that cue list. So if you've got a bunch of subs doing something. Now, one concept that is a little frustrating with EOS, and you just gotta come up with a way to deal with it, is releasing content from different places. Queue lists are fairly easy to deal with because you can make a master queue list that just asserts and it'll just grab everything and leave the other queue lists essentially intact so that the next time you press go, those queue lists will take control again. Submasters can be more difficult because you kind of have to manually stop them. Sometimes I make these macros that just release sub 101 through 200 or whatever. At one point, I just made a bunch of those, and I carry them around with me. I use them every once in a while. Again, partitioning your rig into an intelligible format helps with that because you don't need to make it on site. This is something you made beforehand. A macro to remove manual data when you're busking, oftentimes you're using manual data to send something to red, and then you bring it up, and then you put it in a focus, and then you do all these sorts of things. So when you hit that button, how are you going to get rid of all that manual data? A macro that takes your specialty fixtures, whatever that group is, right? You're going to use the same group all the time. Take those specialty fixtures to zero in the time of your button. So if you got a snap button that you're going to go into, you'll use your snap macro. If you've got a 3-second button, you might use your 3-second macro. If you got a 10-second button, go ahead and use the 3-second macro. You know, it's fine. You just don't want to be snapping out of a slow song. So you get all the channels out, and then you can basically take those groups, sneak them to whatever the background state that the master channel list just sent them to, and then sneak them back out. Right? It's just a quick, down, dirty way to get things off, get them back to where you want them to be. You know, the thing about the applause queue and the generic queue, that's your home base. That's where you know where everything's at. When you're busking, it's easy to get really confused about where your subs are and where this is at and all that sort of thing. All right, so we've got some basic concepts. We've got some basic palettes and effects, and we got all that. So now we need to build our content when we get on site. So if you haven't had a chance to play with the rig, you didn't know what the rig is when you showed up, these are the kind of just like quick down and dirty groups you might make, one for each fixture type, a group for all, a group for like everything that might have color. So you can go everything in color in red, what your generic fixtures are, your base look fixtures. Do you have how you partitioned your rig? Using the word partition with EOS is a little weird. I don't mean like a desk partition. I mean how you partitioned out your different specialty looks. I like to make random groups of each, and time permitting, ordered groups. So you can do things from center out, mirror in, mirror out, that sort of thing. Presets, oftentimes it's good practice to just build 10 really good presets. And these presets play well with each other. It's kind of a manageable amount of work. And you can use those as building blocks to like just shove information into all of the queue lists and that sort of thing you need to make. When I get to building queue lists, I tend to make queue lists that look kind of like this. Again, there's definitely no rules. I like to make a queue list of warm colors. So that every time I hit that, at least I get a change, but I kind of know it's all in the same family. So if it's a rosy, upbeat song, I might go to the warm cue list. When you're mixing a show live, sometimes you're just looking for a variation of looks. You don't want it to all look the same from song to song to song. I like to make a list of cool colors, opposing colors for those, you know, random songs that can take it. You don't want to do, you know, magenta on yellow for much, but occasionally it's nice to just do something random. A list that's just doing focus moves in a slow, focus moves in a fast, list that might do 1, 2, 3 intensity bumps for certain kind of fixtures. It's sometimes nice to just throw stuff in a moving effect, have their intensities off, and then just bump, 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 bump. It's just a way of getting to the beat of the music, which is the, you know, in an upbeat song, that's the only thing you really need to do. You know, back to that, don't matter what it looks like. I mean, everything needs to look appropriate. That's usually my rule. And as long as the transitions are right on with the music, nobody's going to know if that wasn't what you intended, because it looks like what you intended. And the artist will think you intended it. The only person who knows that you wanted to go blue for this bridge and you didn't is you. A typical cue list for me is about 5 to 10 looks. I like to link the last queue to the first queue. Anybody have an idea why that might be? Because you're going to hit that list a lot, right? And so you want to make a loop. I like to make the back time on the console zero, because now I've got a list that can do two things. I can go forward in whatever that standard time is, or I can bump, 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 bump backwards. The thing is, when you get to the end of the list, you can't loop anymore. So I like to make a macro. It says, I make a macro for each list I'm going to do this with. And it says, go to this list number, the last queue in time zero. So queue 0.1, it comes before the first queue in the list. It's usually a copy of the last queue in the list, and it takes you to the last queue when you get there. So since you're bumping in time zero up to the top, you get to the top and it bumps you back down to the end. And then if you hit go, you go to Q1, and if you hit back, you go to Q4, or if there's 10, you know. It's just a quick, easy way of making a circle with timing that works. One concept I really, really like in busking, we can talk about this more in class if you guys want. I like queueless variables. So take a couple queue lists. It doesn't matter the number. It doesn't matter what the content is. They're always the same. And you make some macros that just record a look through those lists and then execute the list. The concept of a queue list variable is I've mixed this thing live, or I've mixed this thing on my busking surface, and I really like the look. Well, you're only going to use it for this song, right? This is a one-night show. You don't need to record it to a preset and record it into a queue list or whatever. Just make a macro that says record to that list, my variable, that variable list of looks that I like for this one song. You're going to overwrite it in the next song. It doesn't matter. But that way, if you have a verse look you like, the chorus picks up, you go to Amber, you go to this, you do that, everything's moving around. There's no way you're going to get back to that verse look. Well, now you have a way, a one button press way. Record a cue list variable, hit go on that variable when you want to go back to your nice verse look. Anyway, there's the slide. You guys can figure it out. We can talk about it more. Submasters, I'm just going to run out of time. What time is it? Oh, boy. So I like to make subs effects for specific groups. Like we talked about partitioning all those looks out. So effects on subs can be really difficult because it's always like this two button press thing. There's two kinds of ways to get around that. You can make effects subs, which will allow you to preset the fader to full, and then when you hit go, it'll play. The downside of that is it can only have the effect data. You can't put any non-intensity parameter data in it. You can't put more than one effect in it. It's kind of limiting. A way to make a complex look, as complex as you want, playback from a sub in a single button press, make all the intensity from your sub derived from an effect. So make an effect with one step, it takes the intensity to full. You've now confused the console. It thinks that your intensity is a non-intensity parameter data. You can preset your fader to full, it won't fire, and then when you hit go on your submaster, everything will play. Non-intensity parameter data, whatever other effects are in it, and that kind of thing. One of the reasons to use subs over cue lists for this kind of work is subs have an out time and they have a concept of release. Cue lists are really sticky. Once a cue list grabs hold of a channel, it really doesn't want to give it up unless you do some sort of like release, load kind of thing. A submaster, you just hit go once, it'll come in with whatever timing you want, play for whatever duration you want, and then go away. It's as if it never happened. Intensity masters for specific groups, so same as inhibitives, bumps to specific color. I like to use a lot of sub timing. It adds a lot of detail. So if you are like bump, 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 all in zero time, if you just change the out time to 1 second or a half second, you'll find that there's a lot more detail in your look because it'll snap on the way you want and then come out nice and slow. And it's just something that's pleasing to the audience. I wanted to leave some time for questions because I'm sure I'm going too fast. But anyway, system settings, like we talked about, I like to make a back time of zero. For all those reasons I talked about in the cue lists. That's the only reason I do it. AutoMark, you got to make some decisions about whether you want to use AutoMark in a situation like this. I tend not to, because you know, a lot of the times you have data in queue lists where the intensities are off, but lots of things are changing, like a list of focus palettes. You might be changing your specialty looks as well, right? Everybody goes to a cross look. In the next queue, everybody goes to cross look too, but only a certain number of your fixtures actually have intensity in them at any given time, so that you have all these subs up here that can do other stuff. So if you have AutoMark on, all of your specialty fixtures that might be in those queue lists are marking. Maybe the way your show is structured, you really want to use AutoMark. One way you can do it, whenever I use AutoMark, I make an intensity palette. I call it Mark. And it's just, it takes all the fixtures to 0.1%. The output is zero, but they're active. And you know, it's just a concept from other kinds of desks where you can mark a specific fixture, not have them, you know. It's funny that I label it Mark in order to dissuade the console from actually marking the light, but that's what I do. Capture enabled, I run absolutely everything with capture enabled. If you guys don't know what capture is, it's a function on the desk to make all your manual values act more like a programmer. So if you've captured a bunch of manual data, you've put things in a specific color you like or a specific focus you like, as you're running through all your other lists, those things won't change. If you don't have capture on, you'll make the nice, pretty look, and then you'll hit go on some random thing, and it just happened to have an assert, because whatever, you were building fast, or it needed an assert, or whatever, it'll wipe out all that data. Maybe that's great in the theatrical applications that you normally work in, but if you have a look you like, use capture enabled, because the playback won't take it away. Macros, we could talk about macros forever and ever and ever. Manual time macros are really useful. The easiest way to learn about what a manual time macro is, in setup, you can set a specific manual time. So typically it's set to zero, right? Channel one at full enter happens in 0 seconds. If you're in live and you hit learn, you can go to setup and change that manual time to say 3. And then exit, and then unlearn, you know, turn learn off. And now you have this macro that'll change your manual timing values to 3 seconds long. You can do that on a per parameter basis. So if you make a rack of macros, you know, they can make your color bumps last 3 seconds, but your intensity will go in zero or whatever it is. I mean, that doesn't make much sense. But then for all of the stuff you might traditionally use submasters for, that's great. You don't want to take up your busking surface to run the house lights, to run the DF50s, to run the work lights, the running lights, whatever that is. I tend to make macros to just take care of it. You throw them on a magic sheet, whatever. It's just a way of cleaning up some space. So I guess now's the time for a demonstration. So I picked this song quite literally on the airplane over. I wanted this demonstration to be sort of as realistic as humanly possible, right? So I spent some time on the rig for the class, and on Monday I spent about 5 hours just kind of programming out a busking rig. All the focuses, all the, you know, the colors were already done, obviously, the effects were already done, we already talked about that. So just the busking surface as I might use it. And then on the plane, I picked a song. This is, there's no real reason I picked this song. I've done this song before, so it was kind of nice, you know, I could try to add some detail. When you busk a song that you don't know, you know, the only way to get through it is to do less. But it's a really hard song to play live, so you'll see me screw up, you'll see me like miss a transition, the capture might not be fast enough, so you know, you'll see all these like little things, but in the aggregate, the looks will be okay. You know, if you're in the right place at the right time, this is definitely the kind of artist you might end up busking for. All right, here we go.
My pressure a little bit high. Thank you guys so much for coming out. Yeah. Oh, man. Thank you.
Rock song. So how many noticed like that I messed up like 10 times? Boom, perfect, thank you. You know, it's good to be knocked down a couple pegs by some random person in the audience. No, I'm kidding. So can we bring the audience lights up? Because that's about it for my presentation. I would love, what time is it? 12:52. So I wanted to leave about 20 minutes of questions because I know I rifled through a bunch of concepts really fast. What kind of situations do you guys have? What kind of questions do you have? How can I help you? Go for it.
So when you were talking about master cue list, is that just the one you put on the?
That's the cue list I put on the master fader. I like to put it on the master fader because you saw at the end of the song, right, there's a bunch of, for lack of a better word, crap going on. And you know, sometimes it's hard to get over there. You know, you can play it with your elbow if you got everything, you know, your fingers taken up.
It does knock out the other
cue.
It does knock out the other
cue. It does, yeah. So that button cue is a full assert, and every channel's in that button cue, every channel in my rig. So that full assert will take away control from any LTP submasters that are playing. It'll take away control from any LTP cue list that's playing. It's a full effect stop. If you type, if you select all your channels, just hit that all group and hit stop effect, that'll make like a super stop effect. And you can record that into your cues now in 2.3. Anything else?
Doing more with less gear.
Doing more with less gear is harder. So, no, you know, when I was at the Orpheum, we had two 30K Parkan rigs, and we would oftentimes bring in six up spot units and six wash units. Is that less gear, or how much less gear?
But still more than I'm used
to. Yeah. So if you've got only six, say, moving lights, those are going to be your specialty lights. Don't rely on those for your main look. You know, busking a Parkan rig's a little bit different because you might just bust the whole thing live. A lot of these concepts are about having extra gear, but they are applicable to any situation. But if you're just mixing it live, you know, you can just break out a set of submasters to just mix your colors, right? Your Parkan rigs tend to be in six color washes with some ACLs and some Leco key light or whatever it is. Is that about where you're at? Yeah. That's where I come from. That's what I always did. So, you know, the typical rig was on an express, you know, in that kind of situation, and your 24 submasters could, like, get you through it. You make four or five effect submasters, a submaster for your house lights, and then a bunch of, like, broken up stuff for your, for the rest of your Parkans. It's less work. You don't need to get this detailed if you're just doing that kind of thing. You're concentrating on, you know, intensity effects.
You run that off a magic sheet?
I run everything off of magic sheets. We'll go through it in class. Magic sheets stay where you put them. They don't change. So you just make a macro that says, I want this magic sheet, and it goes exactly there. Direct selects, there's no way to say, I want this tab with these direct selects to go exactly here. If you put points in your direct select list, the downstream snapshots will change. Things will move around. Go.
Do you also make direct selects when you?
Nope, I don't use them at all. I wouldn't advocate like tomorrow you give up direct selects. They're a fabulous tool, but they were something that just wasn't specific enough for me, and I just moved forward. Yeah?
Do you have any advice for people who are stuck with a single cue list, like on an album?
Yeah, make a lot of subs. Subs are cool. Subs are great. They have an out time. They have a concept of release. Yeah, get good with effects on subs. Practice the piano. You know, I mean, a lot of this is just playing music. So, you know, building a structure. We can hang out. You know, is there a more, like, specific thing? You're not going to do, like, the cue list based movement stuff. Or if you do, you know, maybe make some macros. Can you make macros on an element?
Yep.
And you can make magic sheets?
Yep.
Great. So make a macro that'll, you know, take you to, that'll load into pending like some focus moves or something like that. And then you can, I'd have to do it to see how it worked with like tracking and stuff. But then you can make macros that'll put into pending your master button queue. So at least then you could make a distributed amount of looks and just kind of bounce in between them using macros to load into pending a little bit and then always get to a button of some kind. You could make different loops inside that single queue list. I don't know, we could work some out. it's not gonna be perfect, right? You're on an element in a small house. Like you have to find ways to work around it. what's that? Yeah, I mean, anyway, marketing, will you talk to this disgruntled man to the right? anyone else?
You mentioned using macros for things that you don't want to use subs for, like websites and users. Well, are those capture or are they virtual subs?
Yeah, so oftentimes, let's say you have house lights and you want to put them in a sub and you want to give that sub timing, because that's nice, right? So you do all that. It comes up in 3 seconds, it goes out in 3 seconds. Perfect. Learn a macro and just hit that sub button, and the macro will say something like sub bump 99 or whatever it is that channel is. And then that's like a toggle state. You know, that macro, you fire it once, it bumps the button, the lights come up. You fire it a second time, it bumps the button, the lights go out. Same macro. Because the macro is not sending the sub to a specific level, it's just hitting go on the sub. So you know, to the best of your ability, you put all the transition times in the target that you want. That's just a way of making less macros.
But again, those would still be real subs, but just higher.
Those are real subs. You know, you have a limited amount of surface. You know, if you're busking a show and God forbid all you have is an EOS with 10 faders, like you've really gotta. There's not a lot there, right? You gotta fire a fader page, get to a specific fader setup, and get through that song with just those 10 faders. Now, in some ways, that's a nice way to make a lot of different looks for different songs, because you'll make different fader pages, and you don't run into this problem of like going to the same sub every time because you're used to it. You know, when you're busking a show, you'll oftentimes find like that hit to white or whatever. I'm gonna go to that a lot because I'm comfortable with it. It's like a comfy little sweater and I'm gonna go there all the time. But then by the time you've worn that sweater for the whole show, like it kind of felt the same and you feel like you didn't do your job. Anyone else?
Were you in the generic queue the whole time?
Yeah, so because of the way I structured the generic queue, I did a first music queue that brought up the washes. Because I knew I was going to fly them out and do some stuff. And in the generic queue, the washes weren't very bright. A first music queue can be nice. It's just a nice, slow way to get into something, right? You just need to go somewhere. Like I said, it doesn't exactly matter what it looks like as long as everything looks appropriate. But yeah, the washes and the backlight and all that stuff stayed in that look essentially the entire time. The focuses were changing. The colors were changing. But the master cue list always had intensity control for those lights. Yeah?
You mentioned how there was a way, if you're live programming, and instead of pressing sneak, you can do something else to move things slowly.
So in setup, there's this thing called manual time. And if you change the manual time for those values, when you do manual stuff, it will go in that time. So, yeah. So, and you can write macros to change it. So, you know, you're doing that Vietnamese dance concert, you don't understand anything that's happening, you don't know what the set list is, and they start some slow Celine Dion song. You know, you might wanna just do a bunch of stuff in live, get a bunch of gobos in and that kind of thing, change your manual, throw a macro that changes your manual time to 3 or 5 or 10 or whatever it is you want. And then as you're making manual changes, they will happen in that amount of time. And then when the song ends and they decide to go to Madonna in Vietnamese, you can hit the zero manual time macro and you will snap, snap, snap your way through it. Yeah?
I didn't see it, but you organize your macros onto a Magic Sheet as well?
Yeah, so in Magic Sheet Design, we will talk about my show file, you'll actually experience my show file. This is my CIA screen. A long time I came up with just this specific way of breaking things up. I put all my macros and navigation and that kind of stuff above the CIA screen. I've got it broken up into programming macros. Some of you are familiar with my offset macros. I put them in here. I've got a bunch of focus stuff. Like I said, I like to make arrays of macros. So here's an array of focus macros where you can, let's say you have four or five groups of people like focusing stuff, and you're not doing a traditional theatrical show where everyone's got an IRFR or whatever and everyone's like controlling their own stuff. In my world, nobody touches my desk but me. Nobody touches my content but me. It's just, it's too short and it would be too crazy. But when I've got four teams of people focusing things, I've got to keep track of who everyone is. And all they say is, give me the next one. Give me the next three lights. Well, I don't really know what that means because A, I can't see you. You're backstage. I don't even know who you are because I'm doing something else. But if I can recognize your voice and attach a variable to it, I can make macros that do things like, oh, that group, right? This is a set of macros that's going to record a channel into a group as a variable, and then another set of macros that say, oh, the channel that's in that group, give me the next light. And then it re-records the group, so you're moving forward. The channel that's in that group, give me the next light. So then, oh, that's John's voice. Next, next, next. That's Noah's voice. Next, next, next. Things for shutters, things, you know, this is the way I structure my stuff. I wouldn't advise anyone to start here, you know. There are definitely no rules when you're making arrays of stuff like this. So identify problems, come up with solutions, and then in your downtime, you just build those solutions. This is not something I did in one day or one year. Anything else? Yeah?
So when you want to put emphasis on, say, guitar solo or something like that,
uh-huh.
That would be in your song, if you actually have the ability to song by song, if you're having a basic plus file,
uh-huh.
That is, and you've never heard the band, then you really have half a sound check.
Yeah, yeah. Horrible.
Then you're just doing that from presets, probably, because you want to be able to go open, white, down.
Oh, in terms of like specials for your guitar player and stuff? Yes. If you feel like you have enough time to do that kind of thing, I would do that. You know, all your band members kind of want to have a backlight so that they're in something, and a front light that is pretty consistent. Hopefully in a situation like this, either you have some follow spots or something, because you're going to struggle to keep up with cueing the music and doing key light. But assuming you don't have any follow spots and you got, you know, two moving lights front of house, yeah, some presets. Give me the guitar player and then roll up the intensity when you feel like it got there. So you keep your intensity out of the presets. It's kind of the only way to go. And you leave those lights, again, as variables. They don't go in any cues. You send them somewhere, you bring them up manually. You take them out manually, you send them somewhere else. That's it. All right, I quit. Thank you very much.